Mintai One here, and welcome back to Subnautica Hardcore Season 4, Episode 2, Return to Jellyshroom Cave. So after last episode, I had to go through about 2.5 hours worth of footage, and the only thing I even really did was to make the Cyclops make a moon pool and upgrade my base a little. I tore down completely the first little storage base I built and transported everything to our first base there in the mushroom forest. Let's take a quick look back and we can check out the Cyclops being built.
Be advised, the Cyclops is designed to be operated by a 3-person crew. Only experienced helms people should attempt to pilot this vehicle solo.
In this episode, we are going to go back to the Jellyshroom Cave. There's usually some good fragments down there, as well as all those data pads. So we also need to gather some magnetite, and that is the best place to go for that here, at least in the beginning, that I've found. We're going to fast forward the action a little. The Cyclops is really fun to drive and to pilot. It really gives you the feel, you know, that you're all alone in this big, huge kind of ship, but it is pretty slow. Here we are. Let's hope that we do not suffer the same fate that we did last time. Same overall plan here, gonna sweep around the outside and see what we can collect and then get all ready and tackle the inside.
Integrating new PDA data.
Son, there is always a pecking order. And in our world, money makes a hierarchy. I pay Maida a fraction of what I pay you, and you a fraction of what I pay me.
If money makes the hierarchy, why is Marguerite making the decisions?
We need her. We let her think what she likes, so long as she does what she's told.
What if she doesn't?
For enough money, she will. People always do.
The conditions in this cave support a microcosm of unique, possibly predatory life forms. Detecting an artificial structure somewhere in the region. New blueprint acquired.
No wonder I've died so many times, I can't even scan a stupid eyeball fish.
New creature discovered.
It's good to have that now that we're running the Cyclops. It takes 6 power cells to run the Cyclops, so now we can charge them back up without having to make a whole bunch.
Integrating new PDA data.
These conniving corporate bourgeois, inbred, incompetent, self-absorbed jerks don't have a damn clue. The kid's not so bad. He's even useful. But I swear, everything that comes out of his father's idiot face is a narcissistic lie. He wants to stay in this cave? His problem. I'm the one doing the heavy lifting. When sea monsters are hunting you, you don't hide. You hunt the sea monsters. Then you build a bigger boat out of sea monster bones and you hunt bigger monsters. Keep going until there aren't any monsters left to hunt you. I'm going deeper. I'm gonna find what shot us down and I'm gonna tear its damn heart out. I started the prep work. The kids taught me how to make enameled glass. I've started stockpiling metal ores to build myself a sea moth. I'll raid the indoor grow beds before I leave.
Okay, I think we are about ready to head on in.
Integrating new PDA data.
I can really make a lot better decisions knowing I've got a full oxygen tank on the side in my equipment slots.
Integrating new PDA data.
We're already 200 meters below sea level. You want to go deeper?
Look around us, Chief. Water leaking through the hull, water outside the hatch. We're drowning real slow. If rescue arrives, whatever shot us down, it's gonna do it again and again until it's shut off. You see an off switch around here, Chief?
Why would it any more likely be half a kilometer down?
Your kid found something on the scanner. There's something down there. Something that shouldn't be.
You're mad!
I'm going all the same, and I've an idea you two are gonna follow. But if you do, be mindful. Your authority stopped at sea level.
Thank you.
Yeah, I didn't like that area at all.
I thought it might get claustrophobic living underwater. Father feels it is. He'd tell me it was childish, but I stare out the window and sometimes I think how lucky I am to see this world up close. Back on the island, I wouldn't have believed the creatures that live down here. The fish, they glow. There's one that's 90% eyeball. Snakes twice the length of a habitat compartment. Certainly, it's not all friendly. Most of the plant life is toxic. Learned that the hard way. But I've managed to coax some marble melons into growing indoors. And when they don't cover our dietary needs, well, we eat the fish themselves. It's a bit gross, but it's nothing they wouldn't do. I've been attempting to document my findings. Father approves. He says understanding is power. That the more we know about this planet, the more we can use it to our advantage. I'm just doing it because it's fun. It's not easy without proper equipment and network access. But the old-fashioned way, observing, taking notes, testing theories, shows me the world in a way a spectroscopic analysis never could. Lately, I've been watching the crab snakes. They ambush their prey as it tries to feed on the mushrooms they hide in. What they don't eat settles on the seabed, which fertilizes the mushrooms, which feeds the herbivores, and so the chain continues. Co-evolution gives me the fuzz.
Welcome aboard, Captain. Integrating new PDA data.
Something incredible just happened. Since we're down here, I had this plan to build equipment and study the life forms we were encountering, but I didn't have enough enameled glass. So, I started looking for a natural substrate that would strengthen the glass we have, and those stalker teeth we've been finding fit the bill. Only, well, we needed more. That's when Marguerite got interested. She actually listened to me. More than I can say for Father. And I worked up the courage to talk about my more tentative theories. When I told her they were attracted to metal deposits, that their teeth get dislodged when they pick them up, her eyes narrowed and she dashed out of the room. 3 hours later, she came back, her pack loaded down with stalker teeth. I asked her about it. She shrugged and said my theories were good. Said she had the meeting out of the palm of her hand. I think she meant it literally. She is incredible. She went out to the kelp forest, armed with just a heat blade, and went fin to fin with a pack of stalkers. On the one hand, that is the coolest thing I have ever heard. On the other, well, I hope the stalkers didn't come off worse than Marguerite did. She had a huge gash on her forearm. I don't think things went as smoothly as she made out. What's the point in surviving here if we have to kill everything that makes it so wonderful? I wish I knew more about these animals. Father won't let me leave the habitat. Maybe with all this glass, we could build a containment unit and get up close to them.
All right, we made it out alive. That's good. Pretty much just gonna kind of roam around here and do some farming. We'll speed this up a little bit. Well, now that we have cleared out the Jellyshroom cave and we didn't die, which was good, the main thing we need to do in the upcoming episodes is to go wreck exploring. We need the rest of that nuclear reactor, we need several pieces for our prawn suit, and then I think pretty much when we have that, we will be ready to trigger the Life Pod 2 radio message and then head down to the Lost River. I've made several bases here in the past. It's a really fun place to build. Those worms are really not very dangerous. You can get grabbed and bit by them several times before really being in too much danger. All we're really going to do is do a little farming as we head back to our base and get prepared to go wreck exploring. If you enjoyed this video, please do not forget to hit that like button. This is Mentai1. Thanks for watching.